Welcome to Extended Hands of God Highway Ministries. It's Monday night, and tonight we have Sister Lawana Waring from Mulberry, Kansas. Sister, whenever you're ready, it's all yours.
Father God, I just come to you today, Lord. I just thank you for this time that we have to come and to spend some time in your word. And Lord, just help us to speak forth the words that you would have us to say. And we just thank you, Lord, that we have this opportunity. I just pray, Lord, for those in this world today that you just, our world needs a touch, Lord. They need to turn back to you. And I just pray, Lord, that you help us to be instruments, to be used, to lead others towards you, towards your light. And we just thank you, Lord, for your saving grace. And I just pray, Lord, you just be with me this morning as I speak these words and be with the songs that are sang and the words that are spoken. Just pray, Lord, this touches someone's heart. Just put instill in us, Lord, a yearning to win the lost to you. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. I'll tell the world how Jesus saved me and how he gave me a life brand new. And I know that if you trust him, that all he gave me, he'll give to you. I'll tell the world that he's my savior. No other one could love me so. My life, my all, is his forever, and where he leads me, I will go. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. I'll tell the world that he is coming. It may be near or far away, but we must live as if his coming would be tomorrow or today. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'm not ashamed his name to bear. I'll tell the world that I'm a Christian. I'll take him with me anywhere. For when he comes and life is over, for those who loved him, there's more to be. Eyes have never seen the wonders that he's preparing for you and me. Oh, tell the world that you're a Christian. Be not ashamed his name to bear. Oh, tell the world that you're a Christian, and take him with you anywhere. Are you afraid to tell people you're a Christian? In this day and age, it's getting harder and harder because of the attacks that Christians are under. I know, for one, I shared a thing on my Facebook page one time on the way that I believed in a certain thing, and I became attacked, because of how I believed. And those people, I told them, I said, well, you have a right to believe what you want to believe, but my word says that that's wrong. So I cannot, conform to that or say that, agree to that. But anyway, you will get very, very badly attacked because of sometimes for the way you believe. Well, this message this morning know, we were challenged by Brother Skip to step out and to step up, and we need to share our faith with others and let others know how we feel about certain things that are considered sin in God's word. And a lot of the things that, you know, we have lots of warnings, even in our daily lives, we have warnings. We need to heed those warnings. And some of our worldly warnings, you know, I know one time I was driving to Chanute, Kansas to pick up my grandchildren, and it was Christmas time, and I was going to pick them up and bring them to the house for, we was going to get to spend a few days with them for the holidays. And so I drove clear to Chanute, picked up my grandchildren, and I was coming back home, and I got about, oh, it was a little town called St. Paul. Well, that little town, and you go through St. Paul, the speed limit drops down to 35, and you better go 35 all the way through St. Paul. And it's not very long, little town, but, you know, coming through there on the highway. And I could see the 45-mile-an-hour sign, so I started speeding up a little bit. Well, then I saw these red and blue lights flashing up on the hill, and I thought, well, he's warning me, and I kind of let off. Well, here he came down the hill after me, and he pulled me over, and I had all four kids in the car with me, and he pulled me over, and he says, you realize you're speeding down through here? And I told him, I said, yes, sir. So I was going 35. I said, but I was just starting to speed up. He said, well, you don't speed up until you get to that 45-mile-an-hour sign. He said, you don't speed up before that. And he kind of shined his flashlight in, you know, around, saw the kids, took my license and all that, and went to check me out. And then he came back up there, and I thought, boy, I'm getting a ticket. My poor grandchildren were, they could tell they were scared because they had been, you know, through some things with their mom and had seen their, you know, both their parents be arrested before. And I thought, well, this is, you know, good for the grandkids. See, grandma get pulled over by the cops. So anyway, they gave me a, he came out there and he says, is this your grandkids with you? And I said, yeah. I said, they're coming. I went to pick them up to take them home for Christmas. And he says, well, I'm just going to give you a warning. He says, but when you come through here, he says, you be sure you don't speed up any till you get to the 45-mile-an-hour sign. He says, and you be careful out there. He says, there's a lot of deer running. He says, you be careful. And I said, okay, thank you, officer. And I'll, you know, and I proceeded. I went on. And I got my warning ticket. That was a warning ticket. In other words, don't speed through that town no more. So, and I have been guilty. I've gotten one speeding ticket in my life. But anyway, I went on through St. Paul, and then I got to Girard, and it's not far from Girard to our home, about 10, 15 miles. And I was between Girard and our road, and I seen flashing blue lights again, but they weren't behind me. They were in front of me. And there was two cars, and it was a great big deer laying in the middle of the road. And one of them had hit that deer, and I guess it fell over and fell in front of the other car, and they both kind of hit the deer. And, you know, I thank God then. I said, thank you, Lord. You know, that could have been me. If that officer back in St. Paul hadn't slowed me down, you know, I could have been at that point about that time, and I could have hit that deer. So I thank God for that warning. Sometimes we need a warning to slow us down, to let us know that we need to be careful. And there's other, you know, a lot of people go to, there's a lot of traffic warnings, you know, in our lives. Yellow light, you're going through the intersection, there'll be a red light, and then there's, you know, then it'll be green, and then it changes to yellow. But a lot of people think yellow means step on the gas. You know, yellow means that you need to slow down and get ready to stop, because when that yellow light goes off, it's going to change to a red light. So you need to go, you know, get ready to stop. That means get ready to stop. This is a warning that you're fixing to have a red light. Have you ever come to a railroad crossing, and you're sitting there, and the lights are on, and the bars are down, and you're sitting there, and there's no train coming, and you think, well, maybe these aren't working. And you'd be surprised at the people that will pull right on around through those cross bars, thinking that, well, the train's not coming. And you're taking a chance when you don't obey the warning signs. Same way with deer crossing. I've never seen a deer cross at the deer crossing sign like they're supposed to, but that's still a warning. And there are lots of warnings in our lives. In our health, you know, our things we eat, medicines we take, there's warning labels on everything telling us, you know, how to follow. And when we read those labels, a lot of us, and we follow those warnings. But do we follow the warnings that God gives us? And I know this challenge thing is that we need to be diligent. In these end days, we really need to be diligent. We've got lost people in our family. There's lost people. Or we might have neighbors that don't even know about the Lord. And we need to get a burden on our heart for those people. And in 2 Timothy chapter 4, I'm going to start with verse 1. It says, I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away from ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Because in these end days, they say that in the coming end days, that there will be, in 2 Timothy and starting in chapter 3, it says, this known also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. From such turn away. For of this sort are they that which creep into houses and lead captives, silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, as James and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds and reprobate concerning the faith, that they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. And if you look around, you see this every day, and even more so since the media, you know, is telling more and more things, and you know, and we have the Facebook and they have Snapchat and they have all this technology. And sometimes technology is a good thing. It can be used to spread the word, and sometimes it's a bad thing. And in John 21, I'm going to go to John 21. This is perhaps one of my most favorite stories in the Bible. And it's after Jesus had been, had come back from the dead. This is when Jesus had came back from the, he rose from the dead and he was out and he saw the disciples out fishing. And he says, Jesus said to them, bring up the fish which you have now caught. And Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of great fishes, 153. And for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken. And Jesus said unto them, come and dine. And then Jesus questions Peter. He says, so when they had dined, Jesus said to Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he said unto him, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He says in him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my sheep. And he saith unto him, to Peter the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. Then spake he, signifying by that what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. And he's calling us all to follow him. And I know Peter, whenever Jesus had been taken to be crucified, you know, and that night when they came and took him in the garden, Peter denied Jesus three times. and he wept bitterly because he knew that when he said that third time that he didn't even know Jesus, he denied him. And you know, Jesus forgave him. That was probably one of the biggest, I don't know, acts of forgiveness. Just imagine what Peter had to have felt to know that Jesus loved him and still wanted him to serve him and still wanted him to follow him and to feed his sheep. And to feed the sheep means we need to be preaching the word and we need to be ready to tell others about Jesus. And that story has always touched my heart whenever Jesus told him, feed my sheep. And feed the sheep means to tell others about Jesus, to tell others about him. And then there's another warning in Colossians in chapter 4, verse it gives as the Christian family, it says, wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well and pleasing unto the Lord. And servants, obey in all things your masters. That means that when we go to work, we got rules to follow at work. And sometimes it ain't exactly what we want to do, but you're supposed to do everything as unto the Lord. And you're supposed to obey the job, you know, your boss at work. And we're supposed to follow our government, even though we don't always agree. We got to pray for our government at all times. And it says in 1 Peter, this is an example of being humble, because warnings are patience and long suffering. We're supposed to wait on the Lord and not disregard the warning signs that are put before us in our lives. And it says, humble yourselves in 1 Peter 5, starting with verse 6. It says, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, will make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. So we are in a life marathon race, and we need to yield to God's will. We need to finish the race that he's put before us. And we don't need to rush. We got to stop and learn from God the things that he has for us. We have to be a vessel of honor, a sanctuary for God. We need to be quick to repent, quick to forgive. We need to be humble enough to take correction. And it's hard to take correction sometimes, but you've got to let him exalt you above your problems. Why are we going through things? Well, sometimes there's a crack in our vessel. We've kind of let things kind of go. And so we get a crack in our vessel. We're supposed to be a vessel of honor. And sometimes those vessels, that things like resentment and bitterness because of not paying attention to the warnings. But God can change our heart, and he can help us to seal those cracks. So we need to slow down and listen to God and stop listening to others' voices. And, you know, we hear our voices all around us all the time telling us, well, you need to do it this way. And in the prodigal son, you know, he was rebellious, and he wanted everything right now. And we're kind of a right now generation. So we need to wait on the Lord, and we need to get a clear direction from the Lord. And he'll exalt us above our problems. He will help us. And I know I have a son right now that he loves eating sweets. And that he's getting the warning signs. He's been told he's got diabetes, and he's got to follow those warnings. And you know, God will heal him. Yeah, God can heal him right now. And he can eat whatever he wants. But sometimes we have those things come up in our body that in the flesh that we need to yield the warning signs, and just he needs to yield to God. He's not following God right now, and I've been praying for him that he comes to a full knowledge of him. So anyway, God just kind of laid all this on my heart, because he tells us in 2 Timothy that the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach and be patient, and in meekness and instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. And we can stand back and we can judge, but these people, they need our love, they need the love of God, and they need us to show that love through our lives, and we need to be diligent in speaking the word and just live our lives where they can see what God's doing in our lives, and they will want to be a part of what we're doing. And just like the prodigal son, when he left and went out on his own and he came to himself. Well, that's how we got, all of us have got children. Maybe not all of us, but you probably know someone that has children that are prodigals right now. And we just got to speak and claim that those kids are going to be coming back into God's fold. And just like my son that has diabetes and his blood sugars were over 900 last week, and he's going back to the doctor today. But he used to serve the Lord and played beautiful music. He could play guitar. He could sing. He's got a talent for the Lord, but he's not using it for the Lord. And that's a burden. I have a daughter in jail that's been on drugs off and on for years. And there's many people that have these problems, but we're supposed to just not sit and worry about those. So that's a warning right there, worrying. And that can crack our vessel. So I laid those down, those children of mine, I've laid them on the altar. And that's what we got to do, lay them on that altar and don't pick them back up and keep praying that God's going to bring them through. And when he does, we're going to have a party like the prodigal son's dad had when he came back in, back home. He had a party and celebrating and said, my son was lost, but now he's found. And I'm going to thank God. I just thank God every day that my children are coming back in. And I just thank God that he's going to start laying more people on my heart to witness to and to not be afraid to witness. And we just need to be bold and step out and step up in our faith. And we need to, like Brother Skip preached and passes on all these preachers, you know, we need to be burdened for the lost because the time is short. And we need to be getting these people in because we don't know. I know it's selfish. I had my neighbor even said last night, oh, I just wish the rapture would happen right now. She said, I wish it would happen right now so we could just get out of this old world and not have to put up with all this. I said, yes, Deborah, I'd like to see the rapture happen. I said, but my heart is burdened for those that are lost. And I said, we need more time to get these people in. And it's kind of selfish of us to want to get out of it. But, you know, there's nothing easy out. It never has been easy. And God said it wasn't going to be easy. But we've got to give this word to the lost so that they can come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. We can't just sit on our desks and not get out and spread the word. And that's what's happened. The church has kind of sat down and quit doing what they need to be doing. And they're trying to tickle their ears and entertain people. And it's not about that. It's about getting souls for the Lord. It's about getting them saved. And we got to get them saved because we don't want to see them go to hell. And we need to get concerned. And if you're not concerned about the lost, you need to search yourself. Search yourself. Because we need to have a burden for the lost. And I'm going to close with this song. But I want to pray a prayer right now. Lord, I just pray that you just use these words for your glory, Lord. And Lord, just lay some soul on our heart today. Lay a soul on our heart that we need to talk to about you. Lord, help us to go out and to pray for those that are sick. Lord, help us to pray for those that are addicted to drugs. And help us, Lord, to reach out to those people, to be there, to give them a drink of cold water, to give them a meal. Whatever it takes for us to show your love, Lord, help us to show your love so that they will want what we have. Help them to see the happiness we have in our lives. And Lord, help us to to want to lead them to you. And I just thank you, Lord, that you're going to use us as a vessel. And Lord, heal the cracks that's in our vessels. And we just thank you for what you're going to do in this situation and in the situations of lives all around us. Help us to be like Peter. And Lord, help us to feed your sheep, because that's what we want to do, Lord. We want to feed your sheep. And we just thank you for giving us that opportunity in Jesus' name. It only takes a spark to get a fire going, and soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread his love to everyone you want to pass it on. What a wondrous time is spring, when all the trees are budding. The birds begin to sing, the flowers start their blooming. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you want to sing. It's fresh like spring. You want to pass it on. I wish for you, my friend, this happiness that I have found. You can depend on him. It matters not where you're bound. I'll shout it from the mountaintop. I want my world to know the Lord of love has come to me. I want to pass it on. And I give it back to Sister Shelley.
Powerful message, Sister LaWanna. Thank you so much for taking the time to come and share. We never want to take for granted that everybody listening knows Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I'm going to say a simple little prayer, and if you believe it in your heart and say it after me, you'll be just as saved as everybody else. Dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I ask you to forgive me. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I invite you into my heart and into my life. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you just prayed that prayer with me, let me be the first to welcome you into the family of God. You just made the best decision of your life. If you didn't, and you wanted to, maybe you still have some questions. Maybe you just need somebody to talk to or pray with you. You can call Pastor Skip at 816-729-6649. We'd love to hear from you, send you some literature and a Bible for free to help you out with your new walk with the Lord. We'd also like to get you on our mailing list if you'd like to start receiving our CDs on a regular basis for free. Or you can go to extendedhandsofgod.org, and on there you'll find all our contact information. We also have a free app you can download to your iPhone or your Android by searching Extended Hands of God at your app store. On both the app and the website, you can listen to all the messages, see who the daily speakers are, and a whole lot more. You can share all this with your friends and family. And thank you again for joining us at Extended Hands of God Highway Ministries.